I'm trying not to sneeze. Hey, this is Sean. What is going on? Oh, that number there. That number, that's an old one. I want to say add 3,000 to that number. And that's how many. What a complete waste of time, Driscoll. Let's watch some more Prime. He's going to talk about how to learn a new programming language. I'm just curious if he says the things that I used to say when I was a not a substitute teacher. I was a fill-in teacher for what language was that? Fortran. And some other language, I can't remember now. This is like 40 years ago. $10 an hour? Sure, why not? $10. I remember back in 81, 82, I would go into a bank. This is before ATM machines. I would drive into the bank, get in line, get the little slip of paper, write my bank account number, my name, all this yada yada yada. How much money I think I have in my account and how much money I want to take out. And I just want to take out 20 bucks. And I give it to the teller. He or she would want all my information, proof of purchase, and then I would wait while what's the word painstakingly? I don't know. Anyway. She would count out, she would say, "Would you like that in two tens or four fives?" And I'd be like, "Four fives, please." That $20 lasted me a week. So she wouldn't see me again for like a week. Some of that money I would use to buy gas with. Now, I'm trying to think if I can get through a day without spending $20 or more. Probably 34, 30 or 40 bucks a day almost. Like, man. Anyway. And I was driving a bomber car. I was driving a 1962 and a half Galaxy 500 hard top. 12 or 13 miles to the gallon if I was lucky. And in California, gas was still $1.29. Even with all the weird taxes California throws on the shit. I mean, now, I mean, gas is like five something almost, because over $3 of it is all tax. So, like, how much of that is actually the gas price? Anyway, let's get to the beginning here. Why does he wear a hoodie? I guess that's his thing. Coders wear hoodies. Where I used to work, everyone had a hoodie. Drove me nuts. People come into the place looking like a thief. Because that's what hoodies wear. That's what thieves wear, is hoodies. Hoodies and backpacks.
So I've learned quite a few different languages through my 20 years as an expert HTML programmer. And during these 20 years, I've kind of developed like a roadmap to learn new languages. And I wanted to take the time to show you how I do that. Because when I first started out, I didn't really have like a direction. But as I started learning and I started.
Oh, I see. He's wearing the hoodie, and then he has his earmuffs over his hoodie because it's cold, obviously.
Getting more proficient, I kind of developed my own little bit of a pattern. Now, the thing is this video is strictly meant for someone not learning their first language. This is really a second and beyond language, and not all languages will really work this way. So I can imagine.
Technically, he's wearing a shirt with a hood. Did Peter Parker ever wear anything like that in the 70s or the 80s? Who wears those? Members only jackets didn't come with hoodies, though they should have. They should have. There should have been. You know what? You know what? The awesome 80s were missing? Hoodies. I'm so glad. I'm so glad that hoodies were not a thing in the 80s. Oh my god. I mean, I have a hoodie. I got it from a company. 3D modeling company. And I used to wear it all the time, but I never had the hoodie. I never wore the hoodie. The hoodie was always on my back. I never put it over my head. There's a movie with Tom Berenger in it, and he's wearing a hoodie, and he's, spoiler alert, he's the killer. Anyway, I don't like those kind of movies. Don't care for it. It's low budget. Here, put this hoodie on. That's your costume for the movie. That's low budget. You don't have to do hair. You don't have to. That's why I hate Star Wars movies, because the Jedi just wear hoodies. It's just a way to save money. Anyone, any stand-in can be wearing that hoodie. You don't know. You don't know. Oh, Mark Hamill's, he's ill today. He's not showing up for photography. Okay, let's have a stand-in. We just need someone to wear his outfit and walk down a hall.
Imagine that if you're learning JavaScript and you want to learn Haskell, this pattern may not 100% line up just because Haskell is such a different language from JavaScript. So the first of three steps that I have,
what is he talking about?
Like a direction. But as I started learning and I started getting more proficient, I kind of developed my own little bit of a pattern. Now, the thing is this video is strictly meant for someone not learning their first language. This is really.
See this pop filter he's got on sideways on his mic? I have that exact same pop filter. I want to get rid of it because I don't have this mic. But then I'm thinking, you know, one day I'll afford this kind of mic that he's got, and then I'll have the pop filter all ready for it.
Really a second and beyond language, and not all languages will really work this way. So I can imagine that if you're learning JavaScript and you want to learn Haskell, this pattern may not 100% line up just because Haskell is such a different language from JavaScript. So the first of three steps that I have is the
Haskell is different from Brainfuck, which is different from APL. I guess it's fun to learn those languages. Then you can say, I've programmed in those things of a sort. But why? See, to me, computing is an art. It's an art form. I choose a language that is a work of art. Python is a work of art. I've programmed in maybe 15 languages. My least favorite one, probably fourth. I hated fourth with a passion. I thought, you know, I would go to the fourth user group meetings, the special interest group. That sounds gay now, but in the late 80s, early 90s, SIGs were everywhere. There was no internet. I had internet. I was the guy who had internet, but in general, there's no internet in the early 90s. None. Because Al Gore wouldn't have invented it yet. The internet lane to the super highway of the internet. He invented that, apparently. There was no WWW yet. There was no HTML yet. There was no web browsers. There was no PPP. Is that what it was called? Is that what I used? What was the other one? There was the SSL or a PPP. Anyway, not until Netscape had come out would we start seeing those kinds of things. Who's your? They didn't say internet provider back then. They said, "Who is your?" What would they call us? Who's your ISP? Who is your internet service provider? Is that what they called it? Yeah, I guess they called it ISP. And you went with either the government's, which was lame, or you went with some private company, usually in a nice neighborhood that was new and got some high-speed cables run through the streets. This is before cell phones, so everything was wired back then. No Wi-Fi yet. No. I mean, if there was fiber, you didn't know about it. I mean, you heard of fiber. You bought fiber all the time. When you buy the stupid little lamp with the fiber optic noodles sticking out, and on the ends are the star constellations. So when you turn off the light and this little lamp thing would rotate and you'd go, ooh. Edmunds Scientific sold a lot of fiber. Anyway. Someone said, hey, let's use this fiber to send light at the speed of light. Infinitely to other homes. Without any... I don't know what the deal was. They had to invent lasers first or something? I forget what they shoot through with. Stupid fiber. I was doing Cat 3, Cat 4. No, I was doing ArcNet, and then I was doing a Token Ring. The other one, and then it was Cat 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I like 6. 6 was okay. Gigabit speed, I think it was. Anyway, trying to backtrack now. Where was I? So some people want to learn the weird languages. I want a language that's, you could easily read it and know how it works. You could easily maintain it, modify it, change it. You don't have to wait to compile the thing. It runs fast enough to do the job. It might not do web server stuff. Web services. I guess you can. Somebody, Dropbox is using Python still, and that's why Dropbox is so damn slow. So I don't see Python being used in the far future for actually doing back end stuff or front end stuff. I still see it as being run locally on a home computer that's fast and getting the job done for the user. And, you know, like all the free CAD, the free draw, the free model, the free 3D, free this, the free that, all the free Illustrator stuff, all these little open app things based on Microsoft and Adobe and 3D Studio Max, all these free apps are written in Python. They're kind of weird. I think it's weird using a 3D modeling program that's written in Python. That's good. That's scary. And is the mouse going to catch up? Is the cursor going to match the movement of my cursor? I hope so. I mean, they're free apps. You can't really complain about a free app. And they're using Python to write these things because Python has all the graphic tools to do it, the graphic libraries, the math, the science. And most of it is free license kind of stuff. I mean, if you're using someone's, like me, I use libraries, and they say, if you use our library, you cannot sell your software. I'm like, okay, whatever. And then like 10 years later, I'm thinking, oh, I just remember I can't sell my software. Oh, man. That's how they advertise their libraries, is that you're saying, hey, I'm using this library and this free program I wrote for you to use.
The exploration / documentation phase. Now, this may take you a little bit depending on your kind of programming chops, but it's a...
Okay, when I was a kid, I did one or two flowcharts as a fun project, because I had just bought the template. The little green thing, with the parallelograms and the squares and the ovals and circles and the diamonds and the triangles and all the little arrows and the little, you drew flowcharts with the thing. And I'm gonna make a flowchart. I don't know of what yet, but I'm gonna make one. It's like, what comes first, the egg or the chicken? Chicken or the egg? Some people in the 70s would say, well, son, you're going to have to make that flowchart first before I'm going to allow you to use our mainframe. Oh, how do you flowchart a Star Trek game you haven't figured out how to write yet? Oh, well, how about you write the program in pseudocode, you run it in your brain, you look at the code in your head and you're running it in your head. That's called desk checking. No one does that anymore. And you look at your code, you stare at it, you focus on it for a couple of days before you go back to the lab, the laboratory. And the guy running the machines there, he's like, if it's something interesting, like, I mean, if I was old enough and I showed him a thing that prints out random porn images from the mainframe's hard drive, he'd be like, oh yeah, go ahead and type that in. But no, I wasn't old enough to do that, and I didn't know how to I didn't know the commands to access a file on the mainframe. I didn't have access to the computer manuals. So I'm just writing stuff in pseudocode. This is how it's going to work. And then once I get it, I show it to a friend. He's looking it over, and he's like, I would use this calculation for the random number generator. I'm like, what? You think I'll be faster? Because these are mainframes. They're slow as fuck. You think that random number generator is better? Do I have to do a seed? I hate doing seeds. I was hoping I could just base the time off of the time of, like, the hour, the minutes, and seconds. Take that number, use that as a seed. You think that would work? The seed rotates every 24 hours. Well, throw in like a month or something, or throw in a year. No, throw in the day of the week. That way it only rotates, what, every 7 days, the seed? So, you know, you're fussing and fiddling with that because you want your Star Trek galaxy to be different every time you start the game. And Star Trek's a one-shot, so you got basically, I don't know, 40 minutes to win the game before someone says, you know, it would have been nice if one of the adults in the room said, make sure you shut the lights off when you leave and lock the door. No, that would never happen. I know you're here, I know you signed in for the hour, but I'm going home now, so can you, like, get out of here. And kids didn't have backpacks back then. There was no such thing as a backpack. No, I mean, there were backpacks, but you only used them for camping or climbing Mount Everest. No one walked around outside with a backpack on. It was not a thing. There was no vagabonds. That wasn't a thing yet where I lived. So, you know, you're carrying all these heavy books in your hand. You know, everyone walked to school with books in their hands. Kill me now, you know. No, we had lockers. That's right. In high school, in junior high, did we have lockers? I know in high school, we had lockers. We would just lock our books in the lockers and go home without any books. It was glorious. Mr. Driscoll, did you do your homework assignment? The book was in the locker until I came back to school. So, I hated school. I loved college, but I hated kindergarten through senior year. I liked college. College was like way better because the teachers actually knew what they were talking about, and it was more professional. And what they were teaching you was stuff you actually needed to know. It was more than just being a good citizenship student, or what do they call it? Most likely to succeed, or the class clown, or the best dressed, or the best athlete, or whatever the yearbooks used to do. I don't even know if they still have yearbooks, because kids can't read nowadays. Everyone's on a phone anyway. They just go on TikTok to see what their yearbook says about them. The, So I would show the guy my pseudocode. He'd look at it and whatever. He still wanted a flowchart. But once I got the pseudocode written, I could totally write a flowchart from the pseudocode. It was either go through that. What were those guys called? They were called priests? Computer priests? I guess nowadays they're called gatekeepers, but when I was a kid, they were called the system operator, some kind of priest. There are two kinds of priests. There was you had the one guy, they divvied up these jobs into a key punch operator, computer programmer, computer operator. I was a computer operator, thinking, this will pay the rent. It did. Being a computer operator was boring as hell. That's the guy who just flips switches. He doesn't write any code. He just flips on the switches. And when all the lights are green, the trap is clean, kind of a thing. Doesn't really know what the computer's doing, but he's just following the operation manual. Boring as hell. Usually a night shift job. Come in at 10 o'clock and leave at 7 in the morning, something like that. And so I do the flowchart. I get to type in the program. And you get a bug. You get a bug in your software. Syntax error. And, you know, being a guy, you know, being a normal red-blooded American, you don't ask for directions. Men don't ask for directions. They don't ask for help. It's a guy thing. Because guys are supposed to be smart. And when you're a kid, you know, I was like, what, 16, 15, 16? I didn't know. I didn't know life experience yet. Now, knowing what I know now, I'd be like, can you help me? Could you help me with my Star Trek? My Klingons cause a syntax error when they warp into the sector. He'd be like, dude. See, that's the thing, is the priests don't want to help you. Even the girl that loads your freaking cards into the card reader, she won't help you. She doesn't know how to program. She just does the cards. God, it's frustrating even thinking about this. This is when I would just go get on my bike, ride to the mall. There was two Radio Shacks at this mall. That's how big it was. And they had Tandy computers on display. Guess what I would do all summer long, every day. There's no school in the summer, right? So every day in the summer, I'd ride my bike or ride my skateboard or run to the mall, get there as soon as the store opens, start typing away. Because the night before, I'm writing my Star Trek game. So I'm writing Star Trek games for a Tandy Radio Shack. You know, they called it the Trash 80, came with Microsoft Basic, Level 1 Basic. And it was the Model 1, Level 1, something, anyway. The Basic was glorious, it was decent for 1977. And I'd be there from, I was doing the hacker diet. The hacker diet, that's when you type from like 11 in the morning until 4 in the afternoon without a break. And people are standing around you. They're watching you. You type run. It runs. It does something. Psh, syntax error. Oh, you look at your notes. You got got a whole three-ring binder of handwritten listing crap because there was no printer hooked up to the thing, so you had to just write the code by hand. Oh, okay, I know what to do, and retype the line. Sometimes you hit and renumber a lot of times, because you're running out of room. Then you have to write down your paper what the new line numbers are. Ah, it was a nightmare. But yeah, I wanted the Enterprise to move across the screen and be shooting at the Doomsday Machine. The Doomsday Machine is coming at the Enterprise. That kind of stuff. In glorious black and white. What was the resolution on those things? Was it something like 64 by 32 or 128 by 32? Some godforsaken resolution. Just white. And the pixels were made of pixels, so each dot on the screen was a rectangle, a huge ass rectangle, almost the size of a character. So it was really hard doing graphics at that ratio of pixel. I said to the guy, when's that new computer coming out that has higher resolution? Next year. Like, next year? Gah. I was always trying to get my dad to buy a home computer. It's like, get a job. I'm only 12. You know, that kind of thing. I had to get a job before I could buy my own computer. He didn't want a computer. What does he want a computer for? Computers are for nerds. And it's like, oh. I thought all my life until I was 12, I thought computers were for nerds. I was right. But I refused to be the nerd. I refused to be the guy with tape on his glasses and the pocket protector with the clipboard. I refused to be that guy. I just wanted to be a normie at a computer doing amazing software. The nerds, they were doing the weird stuff, like drivers. They were doing the drivers, printer drivers, tape drivers, sound drivers. They were doing calculus stuff. They were doing calculator stuff on a computer. It's like, you already have a scientific, yep. You have a Timex, or no, you have a Texas Instruments, or you have a Hewlett-Packard calculator. What are you doing this on the computer for? Oh, you waste. I could be doing my Star Trek game. Only one person could use the mainframe at a time back in the day. There was only one deck writer too. Only one. And that ribbon, we wore out that ribbon. We killed it. We didn't have a terminal. We didn't have a CRT with the keyboard. No, we had a deck writer too. Our screen was green bar paper that shot out of it. You always made sure the box was straight underneath the printer because your feet would hit the printer box. Because the printer and the terminal were the same thing. And you're sitting there under with your knees underneath the keyboard / printer. And you're trying not to kick the box. Because if the box is crooked, then the paper jams. You don't want your paper jamming in the middle of some, what do they call it? You waited an hour for the answer to 42, and it's printing. It's printing the answer to 42. Or the question, no, it's printing the question to 42. That's what it's doing. And so it's like, and then it jams. And when the paper jams, the printer doesn't care. It just prints all the data on one line until it's just a solid black ink line on the paper. Like, That happens sometimes. There would just be one less nerd in the neighborhood when that would happen. What happened to Herman? Who? That name doesn't ring any bells.
Really simple process. So practically speaking, what that means is going to Advent of Code and starting to solve problems. And why I choose this is a couple reasons. First off, you'll notice right here is that this should be in a file. You have to read from a file system. If you don't know, file reading can fail. Therefore, there's going to be errors. So it gives me a chance to understand how errors work in the system, how string processing works in the system, if, while, iterator, structures, enums, kind of like it just gives me a good overview of the language and what tools are really available for me to be able to solve problems in. It also gives me a chance to look at how they handle null and undefined, because in Rust, it's going to be an option, whereas in TypeScript, it's going to be null or undefined.
I should have drank some Starbucks triple shot French vanilla Frappuccino in a can. What are we're doing a... I don't like word problems when I'm doing a computer project, but I can see his point. So he's got elves. Elves take turns writing down the number of calories contained by the various meals, snacks, rations, etc. that they brought with them. One item per line. Each elf separates their own inventory from the previous elf's inventory, if any, by a blank line. For example, suppose the elves finish writing their items, categories, and end up with the following list. Okay, so we got to find out which elf had which items. Five elves, so you got five sections here. Oh man, it's been 1,000 years since I've seen a dot in the center of a zero. Wasn't I just talking about the Trash 80? Isn't that how the numbers on the Trash 80 and on the Commodore PET? Did the Commodore PET put dots in its zeros? Is that a Linux thing? He uses Linux. Is this something that... Is this how MD files... Well, technically this is HTML. Could be an MD file. I'm scrolling. I can't scroll this.
And so they're like very different ways you handle.
Anyway, so the first elf is carrying food with 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. Yeah, yeah. Second one's carrying. Okay. That is a long. This is a long setup for a punchline. Where's the punchline?
It. Pattern matching if statements, right? Like just it's totally different. It gives you kind of a good overview. And every time you run into something you don't understand, you go, you look it up in the documentation, you read about it. That way you kind of just learn by doing. And I think that's a very important point. I am not somebody, and I doubt you are either, someone that can just read through pages upon pages of what the language does, and then boom, look at that. I can program because I'm amazing at it. No, that's just usually not how it works. Usually we learn with our hands more than we learn with our eyes, and we just go in there and we have to kind of program through a bunch of problems to pick everything up.
Okay, so what's the answer? How many apples does Mary have? That's how these things usually end up, which I hate. How fast was train A going into train B? Which train hit which train first? And how fast was each train going at the time? No! I wanted to do video games. I was playing Space War and all the other stuff, Asteroids, those kinds of games, and the vector machines long time ago. Before they were famous. I wanted to do that. I went to the college and I said, they said, are you a student here? Obviously not. I was like 14 or 15. I'm like, no, I'm not a student here. Because you have to show them your student ID before you can go into the computer room. Oh, this is when you could just walk on a campus. Just ride your bike onto campus and just go into a classroom. No security. No security at the campus. None. I remember I walked. It was like the last day of school at the college, which I didn't know. And I'm just walking around looking for the computer lab. I don't even belong at the school. And I opened up this one door, and it was the door behind the instructor who's standing in front of his whole class. It's like an auditorium. So I must have opened like the fire exit door or something. And the teacher turns around and looks at me. He's like, and welcome. What did he say? Ah, a new student to the class. No one laughs. They all laughed at me. So I closed the door. Shh. Walked around the other side of the building. Opened the door. Looked in. He's lecturing. He's saying goodbyes to everybody. They're handing in their last project assignments for the semester or whatever. I'm like, ooh, where's the computers in here? It's like, ah. So I went in on a Saturday. On a Saturday, you could use the computers at the college because there's no school on Saturdays. Free access from 10 to 2 on a Saturday. And I said to the guy, can I work here? Are you hiring? It's like, are you 18? No. And they had terminals with screens. I was like, oh, terminals with screens. And they were saving their stuff somewhere, probably on cards. I was saving stuff on a cassette tape. They didn't have any tape recorders in the college, so it must have been on cards.
The second reason why I really love Advent of Code, which I strongly suggest you do this, is that there's a bunch of problems here, right? I only go so far in Advent of Code, okay? I don't like to go all...
Oh, is this one of those, let me guess. Let me get, without looking at anything. In Fortran, we had to read a picture like this. This would be a picture. And we would use Fortran to filter out the noise in the picture. So you got a clear picture of what you're looking at here. That's probably not what this is. This looks like trees, forest, river, something. And then some mountains.
All the way up, it gets very tedious. But as you go through this, tons of people have either solved the problem or are gonna solve it with you. So you can actually like ask questions, you can bounce answers off of, you can code review other people's solutions. People write blogs about it. There's just a lot of available information about solving these problems.
Oh, hang on, let me look up some. I found it. Project Euler. Euler? No, this is Euler. Project Euler. Years ago, 10 years ago, I think it was, I would go to this website and you got these projects here. I think I got as far as 15. And then I, you know, work, other stuff, IRL stuff happened. I need to come back and continue this. Anyway, you do a problem. These are problems solved by this many people. And you post your solution. And you post... I don't know if you post your code. So here's the first problem. If we list all the natural numbers below 10 that are multiples of 3, 5, 3 or 5, we get 3, 5, 6, and 9. The sum of these multiplies... Is that right? Is that right, grammar? The sum of these multiplies is... Oh. I see. They're using this word here. Okay. I was saying multiples? Oh, the sum of these multiples... I'm wrong. The sum of these multiples is 23. So you add 3 plus 5 plus 6 plus 9. And then find the sum of... all the multipliers of 3 or 5 below 1,000. So you write code to do this one. And you would post your answer. I think you have to sign in to be able to post your answer. I hope this website still goes. It was a free project of publicly funded or something. They were always asking for money. Anyway. So you would start with this one, and then you would do this one, and then you would do this one. Here's Fibonacci. You're adding these numbers. You're adding 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 5, you know, that kind of thing. So like 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, 5 plus, you know, you get it, and so on and so on. Now, what's the problem here? By considering the terms in the Fibonacci sequence whose values do not exceed 4 million, find the sum of the even-valued terms. Oh, man. Like, oh, man. Okay. That's problem number 2. Problem number 3. Oh, here we go. The prime factors of this number are this. What is the largest prime factor of the number? I actually saw this. If I had to do this now, I'd be like, huh? How come I can't highlight? This website won't let me highlight numbers. Why? But yeah, I managed to get to 15, I think. Look how many there is. There's like, each one is harder and harder and harder than the previous one. However, let's say you get to number 50. To be able to do 50 should be kind of easy, because each of these problems builds on what you did previously, you know? So your thought of, your process of thought, quadratic primes, oh no. Then you got Sudoku. My mom plays Sudoku. I have no idea. I have no idea how this works. She's an expert at this stuff. I have no idea. I've never tried it. I see her doing it. I'm like, what a complete waste of time. Well, problem number 6. Problem 96 is, I guess, to solve, write a thing. Solving all 50 puzzles. Find the sum of the 3 digits. What? So we got a text file here. We have to open. It's got the grids, 50 grids. Does that sound right for a game? Because my mom would say, oh, I'm just doing the advanced stuff. Those are too easy. I'm like, what? Anyway, what's the last one? 8. Number 801. Oh, this looks easy. What's the problem here? Oh. Positive integral, I can't even say integral solutions of the equation. Okay. Oh. This is calculus 2 stuff, which I've forgotten all of. I've forgotten all of my calculus 2. I like calculus 3. That was fun. A bold proposition. Let A be an, I don't even know what this is. Is this D&D? What is that? Over a radically integral local field. Ooh. We consider an open-oriented line section. But see, you can't just jump from number 15 to number 836. There's like some steps you have to do first, which is all the problems before that one. Well, that's the last one. What happened? This is as high as it goes. Oh, add and divide. How easy? How hard can add and divide be? Ooh, it's got this thing in the middle. A sequence is created. Yeah. The set. Yeah. Define T. Okay. So far, so good. What's the 148? Oh, I see. I guess the first 10 numbers, maybe. And the first 10 to the second 10 squared is what, 100? Is that much? Fine. What? So you got to find you. You have to find you? Okay. Anyway, so yeah. It's called I used to say Project Bueller, but it's actually pronounced Euler. Project Euler. Euler? There we go. This was the guy. It's named after this guy. He was like a mathematician or something. Anyway, you get your bragging rights when you go on here and you say, hey, I was able to solve all the way to 830. Like, look, okay, like, it tells you how many people have solved it before you even tried it. And look out, look, only 85, ooh, chest sliders. If they didn't describe it as this, I could probably do it. But when they throw math at me, I'm like, I could probably solve it, though, if I knew what they were talking about. Only 85 people have done it, though. Is there a way to sort by solving? Oh, I want to... Oh, the Towers of Hanoi. Ooh. Yeah, I used to play with this as a kid, but I had the listing, so I knew how to... The computer would do the magic stuff according to how the program was typed in, because I didn't. I was just typing in the program. I didn't know what the program did. They probably have like a maze generator in here then. Chasing game? Oh, they got a chasing game. Like Tron, you got the two motorcycles chasing each other, and they're leaving a trail behind them. Anyway. How come only 97 could do the dynamical polynomials? Oh, that's why. I see. Anyway, where were we? Oh, yeah.
Specifically in the language you're looking for. So you'll get like just a bunch of experience right away. So the second one I like to do is a WebSocket server. I think this is super important, and I really, really enjoy kind of this phase of the learning process because I usually build something super simple.
Okay, so that's the thing now. When I was a kid doing the programming, there was no internet. There were files shoved on the internet, and if you knew the TCP address, or the IP address, yeah, if you knew the IP address of the server you needed to go to, you could type in the IP address and boom, you were there. Using some fangled app. It wasn't a web browser, it was just some fangled app that would dial into something, and then you would be on the internet, and then you would say, help. And it would print out a manual of some sort, and then you had to have the internet white pages in your hand. It was a freaking thick book. It was called the Internet White Pages. And it had only, there was no www. It was all IP addresses. And you typed, instead of typing in phone numbers, you typed in the IP addresses for all the universities. And on those servers were text files that you could download or just list. You'd just list them out or type them out. It was just hard drives, folders. That's what the internet was. It was just hard drives with files on them. And it had the stupid names like system file dot sys. Like, what is that? Bootstrap dot, you know, what is that? And if you edited the files, you can get the machines to boot up differently. But normally you didn't have access to those files. Normally it was just FIL, TXT, DAT, BY something, CAT, yeah, B, note, not note. Anyway, you had like note things and book things and category things. Fun times. There was no WebSockets. There were no WebSockets. Everything now is web-based. Everything now is, oh, let's write some apps for the mobile device. That's how it was put 10 years ago. Because 10 years ago, I saw the writing on the wall. Everyone's going to have a freaking iPhone. Everyone. That iTouch thing, that was just a fad. That was just a passing fancy between was it iPod and iPhone? There was iTouch. It was weird. It was an iPhone without the phone. It was just the weirdest thing I ever saw. I said, why did you buy one of those? The iPhone's coming out like next year. Why did you get an iTouch? Well, it's in. As soon as the Android showed up, that was it. Everyone's writing for Android. And the desktops like I have, they collect dust. No one has a desktop at their house. Let's be honest. I tell people, I have a YouTube channel. You do? And they never, they don't care. They don't, no, they're not going to go home and watch my channels on their phone, killing their battery, listening to me yap. Oh, who's that? Oh, it's some coworker of mine. He has a YouTube channel. I don't know what he's talking about. They see it as data minutes being used, or I'm killing my battery. After work, my battery is already dead on my phone. I'm not watching your YouTube channel. That's when my phone's getting charged. So, yeah, people that view my channel and comment on my channel and make video responses, for the most part, have either a Mac or a PC on a desk that they sit in front of. Some people, sort of famous, kind of famous on the interwebs, they only have a freaking phone. So it's like they can't really get back to me. They're in a bad area. There's no Wi-Fi. They can't, their battery, their hard drive's full. The memory is used up. They can't make a long ass video. They don't know how to transfer the video to YouTube and without garble in it. They can't do this live stream from their phone anymore, stuff like that. It's like phones are a pain. And then people type like crap when they use their phone. They don't even bother to grammar, spell, or logisticize what they're typing. It's just, the cat just stepped on your phone? Is that what you posted as a comment?
A chat room client that takes connections. Someone says join and a string. Someone says...
writing ICQ, are we? I used to think, oh, that's fun, I suppose. But you need another computer or something to test it out with, or... Because you want to write your own little instant messenger thing, right? Chatbot thing. Use SMS or whatever the latest craze is. But it's like you're reinventing the wheel. It's already there. Just use what's already there in your own app. But I guess if you're going to learn how to do it, you got to do it from scratch.
Says leave and the string, or they send message string, which is the room of the or the name of the room, and then the message they want to send to everyone in that room. It gives me the ability to hold on to sockets. How do we do sockets? What does the API or the standard actually provide to you in here versus what kind of third-party libraries are there out there? Really gives you a good idea of what the ecosystem is, how modules work in the language, and the
let me look up something here.
There are primitives around it. Do you just have to use threads?
Okay, I skipped a little part by accident here.
Around it, do you just have to use threads? Like, how do you actually work with async in the language? And my third.
Okay, so I found this little thing here. This is another traveler character generator I wrote. It's written in Python, and it spits out HTML code. So I just have to go to this address here, right? But I have to generate. I think I have to add generate at the end of this. So let's see if I can remember that. HTTP, not Domino's. Local. Is it localhost? How do you spell that? Was it 8080? Generate. There we go. Okay, so I go to localhost colon 8080. That's the port. And then slash generate. It brings me to this. And I don't know, let's make five travelers. Boom, there's five travelers. This is using my minimal character generator for NPCs. So these look like NPCs. Using I'm not using the traveler character generator. I'm just using a what's the word? What's the word when you're not doing the thing? It looks like you're emulating. It's emulating that it's running. It's the software is pretending to be using the Mongoose Traveler character generator, but it's not. It's using my homebrew rules when I'm with players that don't have the rules, and I want them to just make characters really fast. In like, I don't know, 10 minutes. In 10 minutes, they can make a character for Mongoose Traveler. So here we go. Yeah, this is HTML. Let's see, view source. So the source looks like this. And so you got head title. It says the title is five NPCs were generated. So this changes, like if I just do one, let's see. If I just did one, how do I get back now? Let's go back, type in a one here. What does it say? Generate, and then I view the source again. It says only one NPC was generated. So I try to do this with all my apps. Have it speak. Instead of saying five NPCs, one NPCs, it's actually looking at the quantities of things. If it's a female, it'll say a female. If it's a guy, it'll say a guy. You know, that kind of thing. It won't say Mr. Susan Williams. You know, it'll say Mrs. or Ms. or Miss. Just to change things up a bit. It wouldn't say Sir or king for every character, male or female. No, that's like when you get those things in the mail and they just fill in the blank with your name and everything starts with Mr. / Mrs. Like lazy programmers do that. And then it grabs an icon from a website. I don't know if that website goes bye-bye. There's no icon there. So it looks like it's just shooting out one long ass line. I don't remember doing that. Just one long ass line. So what? Okay, if I let's say, we'll do 10. So we got 10 people. View the source. Okay, that's more like it. So each line is one person. And it's using tables, and it's got the number. It ends with the TR and a table and body. So whatever it starts with at the top, yeah, it's got HTML there. It just does the reverse at the end. It looks very nice and tidy. It doesn't look like this code was generated by something. This is bare minimum, I think, to do a website, because all it's doing is just white background with text. I want to say these are frames almost. They're not even frames. They're just tables. Each one of these is a table. That's it. Anyway, so since I've been updating the word generator on my other app, I have to go in here and update its word generator so it matches. This person's name is Extra. Extra. Oh no, that's not it. No, that's Extra is. Oh, I see. They're an entertainer, so they're a Hollywood extra. That makes more sense. I was in a panic mode because I'm like, this person's name is Technician. No. Okay, so this is their job: Technician, Extra, Black Sheep. doctor, assistant director, wastrel. I like, whenever I see wastrel, that's the character I'm gonna use. Here's a young, that's their character. They're too young to, they're only 15. I'm only 15, dregs of society class. They got some skills, spying on the travelers. Oh, bastards. This person doesn't even have a title. It's just their name. What does that mean? How, what? So, I don't understand. Scholars don't have names? I'll have to look in the rules again. I thought scholars had at least professor or something like that. Here's a sir. Here's a baron. Baron somebody, somebody, somebody of something. Anyway. Where are we now?
Third goal is usually to build like a larger project, something that's going to make me exercise a lot of patterns and try to build something that has to maintain itself with lots of lines of code. Because often you'll start finding weird chinks in the armor, how memory is stored, how the, you know, the borrow checker works, how bad are your ideas around it, right? It has to get to a certain level before you can really feel the language out. And so for the third one, I really like a good project. And so for my recent kind of endeavors into Zig, I've chosen to build out an interpreter.
Okay, so he's got little projects for people to do to learn programming, and they sound like projects that are worth doing, like practical application type programs. Me, when I'm learning how to program a language, I want to know how do you program Star Trek using the language? Can you? I've written Star Trek in so many languages except for COBOL. I don't think I ever wrote a Star Trek game using COBOL or assembly or Forth. I hated Forth. I hated that. Okay, that brings me back to the early 90s. Special interest groups. I know it's a stupid name. There was one over at General Dynamics before it got torn down. Every third Thursday of the month during my lunchtime, I'd leave work, spend an hour at this user group meeting. They're talking about Forth. I'm thinking about using Forth. I never did use Forth. I hated it. I would come into their user meeting. They're all talking about Forth, how great it is, what their latest projects are they're doing in Forth. At the time, I was doing stuff in Unix, writing Star Trek games, and I was writing it on green bar paper. And I would just quietly sit somewhere in the, it was like a classroom kind of a setup. And I'd just be writing my code. And I would be making content. I would make comments about what they're talking about. You know, serious. I'm asking them serious questions and stuff. I'm not the guy saying, "Oh, your Forth is screwed. Why aren't you guys doing it in assembly? Why don't you do it in machine code? You know, what are you doing Forth for? Why aren't you guys doing C yet? I heard C's doing pretty well these days." You know, I wasn't that guy. I was really interested in Forth. I liked hearing guys talk about languages that they love. It was interesting. I could get. Because I didn't know anyone who programmed in Forth. Nobody. It's like, the Brody guy, he wrote a book on Forth, and like, get that away from me. I'm not touching it. but, don't you even want to try it? No. All of my friends had their own special language, own special operating system that they preferred working on, their own special computer. It wasn't like now where everything's either Android, iOS, macOS, or Windows, or Linux. There might be some operating systems out there, but, you know, distributed Unix doesn't count as anything. Does anyone still use Santa Cruz? SCO Unix, as they used to call it? I don't think so. Yeah, so I would go to these meetings and they would talk about their fourth. Meanwhile, I'm just having an hour lunchtime in nice air-conditioned building, writing my code for when I get home. And I did that for a year. For a year, I was going to their user group meeting. And this was in Kearny Mesa in San Diego, and that was where all the computer shops were at the time, because General Dynamics was there. So all of the third-party contractors were nearby to sell them computer parts when they needed to buy computers and stuff. Anyway, they tore that place down. It's now condominiums and a Kaiser Hospital and some other stuff. It's boring as hell. They even wrecked the road. There used to be a road. It was called Missile Road. And there was a little park there and everything. Anyways, it was the straightest. You could tell this road was built by the engineers because it was the straightest road. It was the levelest road, the straightest road, the smoothest road in all of San Diego. And no one knew about this. It's the one road in San Diego where you could drive 88 miles per hour. No speed bumps. No cops. It wasn't a busy street. It was just a side street. Nobody knew about this, not even the drag racers. Anyway, so when they tore down General Dynamics, guess what they did? They took the road with it. They took away the road. They put some road in there called Lightwave Avenue. Sounds really cool, right? Lightwave Avenue. Destroy the building that worked with laser beams and just call the street Lightwave Avenue. Like when you destroy a whole field of lemon trees and you call the street Lemon Avenue. Or take down all the orange trees and call it Orange Avenue. That's what they did. Lightwave Street or Lightwave Avenue. Lightwave Way. Some stupid gay ass name. Anyway, the gays moved into that neighborhood. But here's the thing. The street. The Lightwave Street zigzags and it's got speed bumps and it's got a fucking stop sign every like half block. For what? There's no intersection. I mean, there's some intersections. They even make you stop in case someone decides to jaywalkers. I don't know, it was stupid. Frito-Lay, they're still there. They got a straight lane, but it's on their property. You have to Basically, you have to get a chain cutter, open the gate, drive your car in there, in the back alley of this mile-long Frito-Lay factory. Oh, you could drive straight as an arrow in their back lot there. Just watch out for the dumpsters and stuff like that. But yeah, nowadays, they got cameras everywhere now. You can't do that. And the UPS thing is around there somewhere. Anyway, the point is that neighborhood used to be the IT section in San Diego. I want to say Qualcomm was around there somewhere. They've all since moved. They've all since gone. California is not business friendly. All those places have been bulldozed. It's nothing but hospitals and hotels now.
This interpreter right here, fantastic book, Thorsten Paul. But why I chose that is that I'm actually going to build the interpreter in TypeScript, then in Rust, and then finally in Zig, so I can actually use the experience from languages that I'm good at into a language.
Man, those three languages, are they good for introductory languages, though? I mean, I know he's not going to do that to people. Is he? JavaScript, Rust, Zig. They're kind of advanced, right? You don't just install it and type in "Hello World." No, it's kind of advanced. I know where he's talking about, but the beginner? That's a crash course, son. That's like I went from being a truck driver to being a full stack developer in just 3 weeks. What? No experience.
language that I am bad at, and I can try to draw similarities, draw differences, how Zig changes its handling of various things. So let me actually give you kind of a good example of that. If you're familiar with TypeScript, building a lexer means you're gonna...
So here's the other thing. When you learn a program, or when you learn to program or do a programming project, guess what happens? It used to be in 5 years, it was obsolete. Everything you learned was obsolete in 5 years. Well, guess what? 18 months, pretty much, it's obsolete, what you learned. So you always constantly have to be learning the new thing, the newest thing. Keep your eyes open. Learn the newest thing all the time. Don't get too attached to your favorite nostalgic programming language. It's going to be gone in 5 years. I mean, it'll still be around, but no one's going to be using it. You'll be left in the dust if you stick to it. Like I said, I've programmed in like 15 different languages. Each one has its pluses and minuses at the time. Would I go back to any of them? No. No.
You're going to come across all these tokens, and you kind of have to create these little tokens. So I have to define the token. I'm going to go in here, and based on all these different conditions, I'll return a token. And at the end, I also then have to check for these more programmatic cases, because there's not a way you can express this all in one statement unless if you...
Yeah, it's not generic enough to do it. So you have specificalities you got to do, like, where's a control code entered? Are you searching for like a specific uppercase special underscored character? You know, that kind of thing. Why can't it just be a simple alpha numeric Arabic thing? No, it's got to be each language has its own specific way of understanding what an empty string is, or a null, or a what is that character called when you hit the space bar? What is that character called? You know, that kind of thing.
Only use if and else's. Whereas with Rust, you can do a match statement in which I can express all these different things simply in the statement. Like, look at this. Hey.
What is that called? I don't use it, but most modern languages have a feature where you can, starts with an R. What is it called? You can use wildcat searches, expressive, it's called expressions, something expressions, but it starts with an R. I don't use it, but it comes in handy. I just can't read it. If I write code like that, I can't read it later. I don't know. In 6 months, I'll look back at the code, I won't know what it's doing. But it's looking for, patterns, and what's the other thing besides patterns? What's the word that goes with patterns now? See, I don't even use that stuff. So I guess I would do it. I guess I've done stuff like this. Anyway, so if you're tokenizing keywords, you don't want, you can tokenize the keyword. It makes the word smaller. You're crunching it kind of to a special code of some sort, especially if you're doing compiling or if you're doing interpreting or something. Really? It's only 11:30.
Hey, if it matches this statement, I will then go through my identifier process. Whereas in TypeScript, that's just a function that's really doing the exact same thing. And the cool part is Zig actually has something very, very similar to it. You'll notice right here, I can do almost the same thing I do in Rust. So I kind of get this cool parts of Rust and Zig, whereas I get more of the ease of handling of TypeScript. So kind of like...
But can you read this though? Can you read this? That's why I like Python, because I can read the code. I don't like languages that have the curly braces. Don't like it. Did Rust have that? Let's go back here. Yeah, Rust has curly braces too. And it has semicolons. See, I can't stand that stuff.
That's just a function that's really doing the...
Oh no, this is TypeScript. Where was his Rust stuff? Oh, here's Rust. Okay, Rust has curly braces and semicolons. Ah, kill me now, kill me now.
Hey, if it matches this statement, I will then go through my identifier process. Whereas in TypeScript, that's just a function that's really doing the exact same thing. And the cool part is Zig actually has something very, very similar to it.
So Zig has braces and semicolons. I can't take it anymore.
Notice right here, I can do almost the same thing I do in Rust. So I kind of get this cool parts of Rust and Zig, whereas I get more of the ease of handling of TypeScript. So kind of like a really cool, interesting middle ground language. And usually by the time I'm done with the project, I have a pretty strong grasp. For me to really know if I like a language, I really do just have to build a few things. And if you don't build a few things, it's really hard to know how the language actually feels. A lot of ideas seem great on paper, but until you build something sufficiently large, they're just ideas. They're not actually concrete. You don't actually know if they're good. They're just whiteboard. And so that's it. That's how I just go about learning languages. I'm going to apply this.
See, I learn languages by doing a fun project that interests me instead of doing a chore project that might be more practical in the real world. Real world is boring to me. I don't want to. Some people are like, hey Driscoll, I wrote this code. We can send messages back and forth to each other. Why? It's like, I want to write a game. I want to write a little simulator. A world that runs in the background while I'm doing other things. Then I can do a snapshot of the world, see how it looks. And that snapshot is the current setting for a one shot that I would hand off to somebody, or I would run it, whatever. But it's just a snapshot of current events, what's going on in these planets and these sectors, kind of a thing. And when the game's not being played, that setting is still in motion doing its things. But how does that help the real world? That's the thing. It's of no interest to the real world. And the real world stuff is no... And I don't want to write a web browser. All these YouTube videos, make a web browser using, you know, some famous, you know, some current language. I don't want to... Or make a text editor. Or make a paint program using this language. No, I don't. That's not interesting to me. And the people just copy-paste the code and then run it. So they'll never understand how it works. But if like, I like chess programs and die-rolling programs and card game programs. You know, basically, you know, gamey type stuff. Something the computer can do is like Risk. I wrote a Risk program you could play against the computer. That was the bee's knees, and it was an online game. So I'm hoping one day someone will make a YouTube video showing that program run. I am not going to go on eBay and rebuy an old computer from 40 years ago just to run the game on. Someone else could do that for me, and then I can just comment on what I'm watching them do. But that was it. Games are more interesting to me than boring stuff like self-driving automobiles. I could care less about the software and those things. Could care less.
This exact same principle here soon on Twitch with OCaml once I get done building out the interpreter in these three languages. And then I'll see, can I still keep applying it even in languages that are very far outside of the languages I know? OCaml being closest to Rust, but a very functional, very different language. My guess is yes, it should not be that hard.
What is he saying, camo? He's been mentioning camo lately. I don't know what that is. Is that a language? So now I have to look up He just found out about Zig like 2 weeks ago. And Mojo apparently isn't even available yet. You have to be on a waiting list to use Mojo. That one looks interesting.
Looking forward to it. Pretty dang excited about it. Oh, I actually forgot the fourth step. The fourth step, of course, is to press the like and subscribe. You know, it just works. It makes you better. I don't know why. The name is the Primogen.
It was our first time in Kyoto.